Hello, everybody in YouTube land. My name is Captain Jeff, and I do this little thing, a little podcast that I call the Airline Pilot Guy Show, and it's primarily an audio podcast. And so I'm here in my studio, my hotel room. I do these shows when I'm on my layovers. And let's see, what was I going to tell you? It's primarily an audio podcast, but decided a little while back to do videos of me sitting here recording the show. But hey, I decided to spice it up a little bit. You notice back there, over here, that's my little logo. And somebody had complained that I had something on a couple episodes ago, like the Weather Channel or something, and you could see the TV in the background. They thought, it's very distracting. So I thought, maybe I could take advantage of the screen back here. So with some of my toys, my gadgets, I was able to connect my iPhone and project this image. Maybe later in subsequent episodes, I can actually put clouds, like flying through clouds or something. I don't know. It'll be fun to play around because that's what I like to do. Anyway, if you want to listen, by the way, to my audio podcast, you can head over to, here, I'm going to put in something right there, airlinepilotguy.com. And then you can press the play button and just listen to my audio podcast. But actually, the best way to listen to a podcast, in my opinion, is not to go to the website or watch it on YouTube. But I like to listen to podcasts out there, mowing the lawn, riding my bike, walking, driving, flying. No, of course, I don't listen to podcasts while I'm flying. I'm listening to the radio, of course, the air traffic control communications. But you get the picture. That's the way I like to listen to podcasts, and many others do as well. And you can do that by subscribing to the show via iTunes, which is probably the most popular way to do it. Or if you have a BlackBerry, it should be on the BlackBerry market, whatever they call that, for podcasts. I should also be in the Windows world on the Windows Store. I'm not sure exactly what you call it. Maybe Xbox. I'm not sure. But if you have a Windows 8 machine, or if you have a Windows phone, Windows 8, whatever that's called, kind of phone, you should be able to find me there. Also, likewise, in the Android world, you should be able to find me. There are great podcasting apps out there that I use on my iPhone, one of them being Pocket Casts, Pocket Cast, and another one a lot of people like to use. I also have it, use it occasionally, Downcast. There's a built-in application on the iOS devices called Podcasts, made by Apple. That works pretty well for a lot of people, so you get the picture. Lots of ways to listen to downloadable audio podcasts. And so if you're watching this video and you'd like to be able to, listen to it while you're doing something else, because these tend to be kind of long, these shows, check it out. So again, head over to airlinepilotguy.com, and then you'll see a subscribe via iTunes or whatever. You know, you can figure it out. So without further ado, I think I'm about ready to begin my audio podcast. So here we go. Oh, by the way, the logo there kind of looks like me, doesn't it? Maybe I need to adjust the hair color, make it a little bit more gray. I don't know. It sort of looks like me. Wait, let me open my eyes. No. All right. Here we go. Hopefully I have my levels just right. Airline Pilot Guy, episode number 78. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from my side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 841 in the Hilton Hotel in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. In this episode, the UPS A300 crash in Birmingham, Alabama, spiders and ATC, GPS jammers, more 787 issues, lots of feedback, of course, and much more. So get all settled in, tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions, electronic devices powered on. Flight 79 is ready for pushback. And I just realized that, did I just say flight 78 or episode 78? What episode is this? Okay, let's do it again. So I'm going to turn off my digital audio recorder here, and I'm going to turn it back on so I have an accurate idea of how long I've been blabbing. And okay, I'm going to leave this in the YouTube video. Because, you know, you're just watching this and it's kind of interesting to see me dork it up, right? Okay, so which episode is this? Number 79, I think, right? Yeah, 79. Okay. Here we go. Take two. Airline Pilot Guy, episode number 79. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from my side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 841 in the Hilton Hotel in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. In this episode, the UPS A300 crash in Birmingham, Alabama, spiders and ATC, GPS jammers, more 787 issues, your feedback, and much, much more. So get all settled in. Tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions, electronic devices powered on. Flight 79 is ready for pushback. Hello, hello, hello. I'm on another trip and I'm recording another podcast. I'm in Milwaukee, as I just mentioned, and it is day number two of a three-day trip. It is Thursday, the 15th of August. And let's see, one of the reasons why I bid this particular rotation or trip is that it gets in really early on day number two. We arrived here Central Time in Milwaukee at like 9:15, 9:20 this morning. So I had a long day to do the show prep and record, and that's what I'm doing right now, obviously. One of the things I did when I got in, though, was I checked out where the closest Catholic church is. And many of you know that I'm a Catholic Christian, and we Catholic Christians have holy days of obligation. Now, every Sunday is a holy day of obligation, but there are also many other days besides Sundays throughout the year that the church has decided it's important for us Catholic Christians to go to worship. And one of those is today, August 15th, and it is the Feast of the Assumption of the Blessed Virgin Mary. And so I did a quick check and saw that I wasn't too far away from the cathedral here in Milwaukee. And so I walked over there and attended Mass at 12:15. Beautiful, by the way, beautiful church, beautiful music, great pipe organ. And so after that, went over to Potbelly's, a place for sandwiches and soup and salads and that kind of thing. Grabbed a sandwich, the wreck, and devoured that, and did a little bit more show prep, and now here I am. Now, I mentioned at the beginning that one of the things we're going to talk about here is something that just happened yesterday, the 14th of August, in the morning, early hours of the morning. A United Parcel Service, UPS, a freight airline here in the United States, well, around the world, actually, was on approach to the Birmingham, Alabama, in the States here, airport, runway 18, and it was dark, obviously, very early in the morning, and they were, I'm not sure which approach they were flying, either the localizer, runway 18, or the GPS RNAV approach, which is also a non-precision approach, has a minimum descent altitude. And what I can tell you here is, oh, and by the way, our hearts, our thoughts, our prayers go to the victims' families and friends, our condolences for all of you who knew the two pilots that perished in the crash. So both pilots on board were killed, but they were the only two humans on board the airplane. Everything else was just packages. And those can be replaced, but human life cannot. So again, our condolences to the two pilots that that passed away. What I can tell you is that they're still collecting data. The National Transportation Safety Board, along with I believe the French BEA, is also involved in the investigation because it's an Airbus A300-600, I believe, freighter. And they are gathering data right now, perishable data, to start doing their analysis. And then, of course, at some point, they'll come up with their conclusion as for the probability of whatever the causal the cause of the crash is. And what I know about Birmingham is that for Acme Airlines, Birmingham is a special airport qualification airport, a SAQ. Which means that there's something about it that's a little bit more difficult to keep in mind or to do when you fly into there or out of there. And in Birmingham, it happens to be, believe it or not, you know, you wouldn't think Alabama would have to, you'd have to worry about terrain, but around the Birmingham airport, there's the some mountains, kind of the foothills of the Appalachians that are going into the northern part of the state there. I think they're part of the Appalachians. But there's a ridge there, and there's some high terrain north to the northeast and east of the airport. If you're coming in from the north and flying an approach to runway 18, it's kind of difficult in many ways because it's the terrain is kind of high, as I mentioned, to the north coming in. The runway is kind of in a hole, and that runway is not the longest runway there. I think it's about 7,000 feet long or so. And the other runway is something like 9,000. I'm not sure. I don't have my notes in front of me exactly. But it's a longer, you know, the other runway, the runway 624, I believe, the one that we normally use at Acme. It's a longer runway. Let's see, what else? There are no precision approaches to runway 18. Which in itself is not necessarily a possible cause or safety factor. Could be. There is a visual system to aid in your glide path. And in this case, it's a precision approach path indicator, a PAPI, just as they had in San Francisco. I'm not comparing the two, but it's the same kind of device that you can use to visually assess whether or not you're on glide path or you're not. And I do know that in my airline's guidance, it says basically that if the PAPI system is not operative, do not attempt landing on runway 18. I'm not sure if the PAPI system was in operation early in the morning, yesterday morning, or not. It is now NOTAMed out of service or unusable, but one of the investigators at the National Transportation Safety Board said that it's not unusual for them to take the PAPI or VASI or whatever they're using out of service after an incident like this because the runway is basically closed and they don't want anybody using it. So we can't really read anything into that particularly right now or so we'll just have to wait and see what evidence is gathered and what analysis reveals. They did recover the black boxes. In fact, I was looking at Twitter right before I recorded the show. And if you want to follow along the investigation, and in fact, they even said during their briefings, their video briefings, which you can find on YouTube, just do YouTube and NTSB as a search, and then you can see all their our videos and their briefings. They said the best way to keep track of investigations that they're doing is by following them on Twitter. And that's at ampersand NTSB if you're a Twitter user. and then you can follow along with what's happening with the investigation on this particular crash and other things that they're investigating. Let's see, what else do I want to say about that? That's about it. So we'll keep our ears and eyes open to see what they come up with after analyzing the flight data recorder and the cockpit voice recorder. Hopefully the those two recorders are still intact. I know that they were that section of the airplane was on fire, and it wasn't until about a I saw on the on Twitter following at NTSB that they did recover the flight data recorder and the cockpit voice recorder. And it took them a while because that part of the airplane was still on fire and smoldering, and they had to wait till it cooled off enough so they could get in there and get the devices and send them to Washington, I believe, is where they do the unpacking of the devices and start doing their analysis. So we'll kind of keep our eyes and ears open for what's happening in that investigation. Okay, let's see. What else did I want to talk about? Let's start off with some corrections. Let's see. I'm not going to try to find something funny to play because it's too much of a hassle. Okay. This is from Mike Rogers, Dr. Mike Rogers. He said, "Hi, Captain. Just a quick note about WAAS, WAS, at major airports. I may have misheard, and if I did, just hit delete." Okay, delete. You didn't miss here. He said, "I thought you said in episode 73 when you were talking about WAS coming to major airports in the future tense. However, they walk among us even now. My understanding is that any RNAV GPS approach that has LPV, whatever that is a WAS-based, and there are oodles of them. Just to pick one at random, see KATL, Atlanta, RNAV GPS, Yankee, runway 9 left. Cheers." Now, I don't have that particular one in my Jeppesen binder, Mike, because the airplane that I fly at ACME is not authorized to fly RNAV approaches. Not yet, anyway. When we get this new cockpit improvement starting toward the end of this year and going through 2014, maybe even into 2015, we're going to have GPS and a new big flat screen panel display. It's going to be a fancy new generation kind of a cockpit display in the airplane that I fly now. And at that point, I'm sure we'll be able to fly RNAV approaches. But I'll take your word for it, Mike. And by the way, speaking of that, just quickly, one of the things I wanted to talk about in the news, speaking of WAS, and I'm not talking about, Steve Wozniak, the Steve Jobs and Steve Wozniak were the two guys that started up Apple Computer. When I hear Woz, I think of him. This in the news just a few days ago, a New Jersey man installed a GPS jammer, and it is interfering with Newark Liberty Airport operations. This man, what's his name? Well, it doesn't matter what his name is. He is a limo driver, I believe, and they have GPS trackers in their vehicles. And this guy, I guess he didn't want his company to... Well, I don't know if he was a limo driver or not. Maybe he was a truck driver. He was some kind of a vehicle driver, and his company had installed GPS trackers in the vehicles, and he didn't like it. So he decided that he was going to outsmart them, and he bought an illegal GPS jammer to thwart the tracking device. The problem is that his work took him near the Newark Liberty Airport, and his GPS jammer, which is available online for less than $100, see the link here. No, I'm just kidding. I'm not selling them. Interfered with the new GPS-based guidance system called SmartPath being tested at the airports. And federal agents tracked the jamming signal to his truck. Oh, it was a truck. And this week, and hit him with a big fine. $32,000. Let's see. So I found out the SmartPath precision landing system is made by Honeywell, and it's the next generation of precision navigation and control. Is a cost-effective ground-based augmentation system, GBAS, more letters there in the letter, the alphabet soup. It's a solution to increase airport capacity, decrease air traffic noise, and reduce weather-related delays. By providing aircraft with very precise navigation data, SmartPath represents the latest technology in Category 1 certified GBAS solution for precision approach and landings, enabling aircraft to fly either complex or straight-in approaches. Easy to install at major cost savings compared to ILSs. So, somebody, probably United, Continental, at Newark Liberty International is doing some testing with this SmartPath system, and this dude's GPS jammer apparently jammed that signal as well, and they couldn't use it. So, wow, I had to go a long way on that one, didn't I? But anyway, speaking of wide area augmentation systems, which is basically ways to kind of augment the global positioning system, you know, the satellites rotate or orbiting around us, around the Earth, and to make it extremely precise for airplanes to get into runways. Okay? So you're right, Mike. I was wrong, as usual. And so I do appreciate your correcting me. And if you're listening out there, you hear me say something wrong, please correct me. I don't want to be disseminating bad information. Okay, and so now it is time for my friends, the Ink Spots. Let's talk about the coffee fund.
I love coffee. I love tea. I love the Java Jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Java and me. A cup.
Yeah. I love that song. I do love Java and beer and wine and all kinds of things. And if you want to contribute to my coffee fund, you may do so by clicking on, well, go to my website. There's a button there that says, buy me a cup of coffee. And that helps, of course, more than just my coffee addiction, but it helps offset some of the costs involved in doing this podcast. You know, I don't get paid to do this. Although if you're an advertiser out there, got a pretty targeted audience for you here. Anyway, no, I'm not doing this for money. I'm doing this because I love aviation. I have a passion for aviation, and I think that someone out there like me needs to kind of help interface with people that maybe aren't pilots and don't understand all this stuff. So I think that, you know, I have the ability to do that in most cases, so that's why I'm doing it. And it's fun. I like podcasting. It's kind of a way for me to play with audio gadgets and stuff. So anyway, if you want to contribute to my coffee fund and help me continue this podcast into the future, you may do so by clicking on that button and buy me a cup of coffee. As Manny, Brent, Navneet, and Daniel did. So thank you guys. I appreciate it. If I don't get an email to you personally, please accept this thank you as my appreciation for contributing to the fund. And thank you, Ink Spots, for... Oh, I meant to fade them out. Apparently that didn't work very well. Sorry. Let's play this here. Dropbox. It's something that I use to help me with the production of this show. Dropbox is a really cool thing to get. Even if you don't use my referral code, you'll love this thing. It's a way to... it's online storage that synchronizes with all of your devices, whether it be a Windows-based PC, a Windows-based, I think they have an application for the Windows phone, an Android phone, an iPhone, iPad, whatever, Macintosh computer, all these devices, they synchronize. It's great. It works well. And they give you, if you sign up for free, they give you 2 gigabytes of storage. I know that's not a lot of storage, but if you have files that you want to share with people, or you want to have on all your, or accessible from all your devices, it's a great way to do it. And it just basically puts a folder on your device, and you just drag stuff over to it, and it just magically shows up everywhere. It's great. So that's one of the things I use for when I get audio feedback for different sound effects, etc., music. I use my Dropbox, and I put it on one of the devices, and it's available to all of my machines. And it's wonderful. And if you want to help me out and add some storage capacity to my, and I already have more than 12 gigabytes of storage. I think I can go all the way up to about 16. But I have plenty now, so don't worry about it if you don't want to bother. But in the show notes, there's a URL, there's a link that you click on and you sign up if you already haven't signed up for Dropbox. So don't go to dropbox.com and sign up. Use my link in the show notes. And then when you sign up, you'll help me by giving me another half a gigabyte of storage. You help yourself. You get a half a gig extra of storage. So instead of getting the 2 gigs, you get 2.5. Good deal. So if you want to, do that, you're welcome to do so. But as I said, I already have a lot of storage. Probably don't need much more. But thank you, Jay Garfield and Arvin, for doing that. Okay, now let's get on with some other stuff here. Let's play this stinger here. I meant to talk about this on the last episode, and I forgot. So let's play this.
Come on, let's go find that spider. And let's find your mom to take care of that spider. Honey, we're in the living room. We need you to kill a spider.
And this.
Chris, I'm scared to death.
And we all are. But our brains secrete a neurotransmitter that enables us to deal with them. Come on.
I don't think I have that particular neurotransmitter.
And why am I playing those clips from Arachnophobia, that movie back, I think it was in the 90s, where they had spiders that went out of control? I don't think I ever watched the movie, actually, so I can't tell you much more about it, but I know it has something to do with spiders, or it did. Anyway, speaking of spiders and aviation, this was a couple weeks ago. The FAA believes that 5 flights at Kansas City International Airport were delayed on Saturday after an infestation of spiders descended upon air traffic controllers. 3 employees were reportedly bitten last week at the Air Traffic Control Center in Olathe, which controls the airspace around Kansas City. Subsequently, the air traffic controllers were evacuated and moved to another area of the building. Exterminators were brought in and found that a spider's nest egg had likely hatched. And here's a quote from CJ Workman with Schendel Pest Control. He said, "You're talking in some spider cases up to 400, and in large breeds you're talking thousands of spiders from one mom." The FAA did not disclose what kind of spiders were behind the delay, but maintained that passengers were in no danger. So, thought that was kind of interesting, kind of funny, kind of odd. So, we have that. So, and another crash of note. This one was a general aviation aircraft, and this was back on the 9th of August. It was a Turbo Commander piloted by I don't know if he's currently a Microsoft executive or a previous Microsoft executive, VP or something like that. Also a pilot, obviously. He was with his son in the Turbo Commander, and they were in the Northeast looking at colleges for the son. And they were going into the Tweed, New Haven, Connecticut airport on August 9th, and they crashed into a couple houses outside of the airport area, of course. And let's see. Did I want to? Oh, yeah. I think I wanted to play something. Hang on. Dun, dun, dun. Here we go.
Tower 6 Center 13622, 7.5
assault. Number 13622, Navy, Tower 4 left down, runway 20.
6-2.
Left downwind for 20622.
622 is the call sign of the turbo commander that crashed.
622, is anybody landed straight in?
Negative, the wind's 19017.
Okay, so he's coming in. The weather is some light rain, I believe. Heavier rain and convective activity to the north of the New Haven area. You'll hear when I resume play, some people talking about altering their route of flight because of the nasty weather. But at the New Haven airport, as far as I can tell, it wasn't like thunderstorm activity. It was just rain. And the guy's coming in from the south, but the winds are out of the south. Like I think he just said 190 at 17 knots, so too much of a tailwind to land. And he's asking, has anybody landed straight in? So apparently, in this case, he has to fly the instrument approach, coming in from the south, heading north, and then do a circling approach around the airport and land to the south. So he says negative, you know, report a left downwind for runway. What is it? Runway 19 or 20, something like that. Let's see. 24. So here, let's resume play here. Oh, this would have been a good time to talk.
4904, go for test. And New York Sound 4904, golf looks like my entire route has gotten ugly for weather. Any chance that I could go straight west and come around behind Poughkeepsie?
Oh, it is 20. Okay. Clear to land. So he's out there maneuvering.
Can you just verify that's for 427?
All right. Again, this is a scanner picking up all kinds of
data. We just want to get a little bit right for weather and just want to verify it's for 427.
Okay, somebody out there deviating for weather. Some other traffic in the area.
Number 122, are you going to be able to maintain visual contact with the airport?
Are you talking to 622?
622, affirmative.
Okay, he said, are you going to be able to maintain visual contact with the airport? I think this is the again, these scanners on liveatc.net sometimes scan multiple frequencies, like approach control, tower, ground control, etc. So I believe that was the tower controller talking to 622, but I'm not positive. Let's resume.
622 is in visual contact now.
Okay.
Okay, 622 is in visual contact, so he sees the runway, and he's maneuvering. And that was the last transmission from 622, the turbo commander. And they crashed. The investigators say that the turbo commander impacted the house, or the houses, inverted about 60 degrees nose down. And they're still doing the investigation here to see what happened, if he lost control, or what exactly happened there. So just thought we'd mention that crash. By the way, the executive from Microsoft, his son, and some people in the house died. I think a total of 5 or 6 people perished in that crash. Okay, 787s. Yeah, you know it. We got to talk about the 787. The Qatar Airlines have a few of these things. And apparently, a week or two ago, there was a problem with one of their 787s. And they kind of tried to keep it quiet. And I found this on a blog called Plane Talking with Ben Sandilands. And it says, after days of stonewalling, it has been confirmed that a Qatar Airways 787 caught fire, according to some reports, in a rear underfloor part of the fuselage last Sunday as it was moving into position to take off from Doha Airport. The fire has been described as serious in some quarters and not serious by the airline, and also by one contact as having extensively damaged an important panel in the electrical bay that also caught fire in a test flight Dreamliner in November 2010, causing an emergency diversion to Laredo, where the jet was evacuated. Okay, this is one of the one of those lithium ion batteries, at least the test flight that did the emergency divert to Laredo in the evacuation. This was one of the electrical bays in the underfloor area toward the back of the airplane that was the cause of the of that diversion in Texas in 2010, and sources are saying that this is the same area from which the fire emanated in the Qatar 787. Let's see. It's assumed that Boeing, as a manufacturer, immediately notified the United States FAA, the certifying authority for the Dreamliners, as to the incident. The U.S. safety investigator, the NTSB, is continuing to seek a cause for the heavy-duty lithium-ion battery problems. Let's see. So, again, not much is known about this incident with the Qatar 787. And then just yesterday or the day before yesterday, I noticed that they were having some more electrical issues with some of the Al Nippon Airways or Airlines, ANA 787, something to do with miswiring of the fire suppression systems on for putting out fires in the engines. And apparently on one of their airplanes, at least, they found that the wiring was wired backwards. So that's not good. So more problems continue to plague the 787. And as a side note, also noticed that the chief engineer, the head of the 787 program, has taken on a new job at Boeing, and something about VP or the head of product development, and somebody else has come in, I guess, to take some of the heat for the 787 program and its problems that they're experiencing. The poor guy probably needs a break. Okay, anything else here in news that I wanted to talk about? You know, I have this in here, and it's been in here forever, and it's a little humor item, and somebody has suggested that I do these pieces of humor on every episode, and I just sometimes forget or sometimes run out of time. So let's just go ahead and do it now. This is from AvWeb, and they have a little segment in one of their newsletters called Short Final. An American Airlines jet landed in Chicago or O'Hare in the early morning before the beginning of a typical busy day. Expecting the usual complex taxi instructions, they instead had the following exchange. American 123. Morning, O'Hare Ground. American 123 clearing 32 left for Kilo 8. O'Hare Ground Control says, American 327 O'Hare Ground. Good morning. Taxi to the gate. After a long pause, American 123 says, do you care how we get there? O'Hare Ground Control says, just stay off the grass and don't cross any runways. So that's kind of funny, because anybody who has ever flown into O'Hare International knows that taxi instructions can be extremely complicated. And to just tell them that you're clear of the runway and you're going to one of the gates, and they just say, taxi to your gate, is extremely unusual and extremely pleasing to hear. So thought you might enjoy that. There's also something here that I wanted to talk about, but perhaps I'll do this in a future episode. But it was a complaint letter that went viral last month. Well, I'll go ahead and read it. What the heck? This is frustrated passenger Arthur Hicks, and he is sending this to LIAT Airlines. Is that Liat? Liat? May I say how considerate it is of you to enable your passengers such an in-depth and thorough tour of the Caribbean? Most other airlines I've traveled on would simply wish to take me from point A to B in rather a hurry. I was intrigued that we were allowed to stop at not a lowly one or two, but a magnificent 6 airports yesterday. And who wants to fly on the same airplane the entire time? We got to change and refuel every step of the way. I particularly enjoyed sampling the security scanners at each and every airport. I find it preposterous that people imagine them all to be the same. And as for being patted down by a variety of islanders, well, I feel as if I've been hugged by most of the Caribbean already. I also found it unique that this was all done on island time, because I do like to have time to absorb the atmosphere of the various departure lounges. As for our arrival, well, who wants to have to take a ferry at the end of all that flying anyway? I'm glad the boat was long gone by the time we arrived into Tortola last night, and that all those noisy bars and restaurants were closed. So thank you, Liat. I now truly understand why you are, quote, the Caribbean airline. P.S. Keep the bag. I never liked it anyway. So he sent this letter to the Caribbean airline, LIAT. It was published in the BVI Beacon, a newspaper in the British Virgin Islands. And apparently that went viral on the interwebs a few weeks to maybe a month or two ago. So, thought you might enjoy that. It's always good to have a sense of humor. Okay, you know what time it is, don't you? It is time for the mailbag.
Captain, incoming message.
Let's start off with Laura. She sent this to me way back, like on the 1st of July. And so I'm now finally getting to it. Sorry, Laura. Good morning, Captain Jeff. I started listening to your podcast not too long ago with episode number 70. I'll keep it brief, as I know you're getting lots of great feedback lately. Here's a little background on me. I formerly worked as a manager of a very small system operations control, SOC, at a tiny 121 charter airline called Dynamic Airways. I am a certified dispatcher and worked as part of the team that got the airline its operating certificate with the FAA, which was not a small undertaking. I'll bet it wasn't. We operated starting in October 2010 for about a year and a half. We had 2 MD-88s. They were former Midwest Airlines airplanes, and one 767-200 X Japan Airlines. About use of the iPad and Dropbox as operational tools, we had a very cool weight and balance iPad app that worked with a company called Aerodata to calculate the weight and balance of the 767, as well as send and receive all the takeoff and landing performance data for each flight. It worked seamlessly with our dispatch tools, and it was easy for the pilots to basically make any last-minute weight and balance or performance data changes on their own from the iPad. You've been talking lately about Dropbox, and we used this extensively to send release packets in PDF form with all weather data, passenger manifests, flight plans, and the flight releases to each flight. It was extremely easy for the dispatcher to drag the final release PDF to the right airplane's Dropbox and have the pilot get it through the iPad app. We were not quite paperless when the airline ceased operations, but it came a long way from where we had started. Thanks for making the great shows and keeping us informed, Laura. Well, thank you, Laura, for giving me that information. And see, another perfect use for the Dropbox app. And I believe that Laura used the, I think Laura was one of the ones that used the Dropbox URL referral link to sign up for a personal Dropbox account and help me get that extra 500 megabytes of data. I do appreciate it. Now, I'm not using mine for operational use at Acme Airlines, because we have a full dispatcher system Tom and Mike are fellow ACME employees, dispatchers. And in fact, Mike, you'll remember Laura. Mike just started a blog not too long ago. And by the way, he's churning out a lot of great articles on his blog called My 50%, MyFiftyPercent.com, My 50%. And you should check it out. Follow him on Facebook and sign up to get his blog posts, because it's really interesting to see stuff from his perspective, from his side of the cockpit. Well, it's not really a cockpit door. His side of the dispatcher door. See what kind of stuff that they run into. And I've been fascinated with it. Mike, keep pumping out that great stuff, that great content. I'm learning a lot about your job, and I think that's important for me doing my job. So got off track there, sorry. So thanks, Laura, for that feedback. Paul writes, great work on the podcast with Airline Pilot Guy. I enjoy listening to the podcast, especially on the longer bus journeys to the downtown hotel from the airport. The reason I write is that I was an ex-military guy like yourself and am now 48 years old and a training captain in an A380 airline. And it's one of the, Emirates. Should you ever need any information from the Middle East or from the A380 glass cockpit operation, then please let me know. I converted to the glass cockpit in the late 90s after flying the VC-10, and he puts in parentheses, steam-driven dials and INS Loran Omega, an air refueler airplane in the Royal Air Force for 10 years. The VC-10, cool. My flying career has been over a 27-year period, and I have 14,000-plus hours. Wow, lots of time. So if you ever feel that you would like any input from me, then please just let me know. Regards, and well done on your efforts, Paul. Thank you, Paul. I know now we have an Airbus 380 Super Jumbo pilot listening to the show. So if any of you out there have a question for Paul, just send it to me, and then I'll ask Paul. Appreciate it, Paul. And let's see, he's also Airbus 330, 343, 345, and now 380 qualified. All as tri qualified. I'm not sure what that means. But anyway, I appreciate your feedback, sir. And keep listening, and maybe we'll use you to answer somebody's question in the future. Speaking of ex-military, this is, I think, from a current military pilot. Carl writes, I think I can offer some hopefully useful advice for the Air Force officer contemplating leaving the service for an airline career. Although I'm not a pilot, I am a former naval officer who left the service for a career in the Merchant Marine. Okay, no, he's not a current military person. But he was a naval officer, and he left the service for a career in the Merchant Marine. While on the surface, they may seem like opposites, there are a number of similarities between the professions that could help inform his decision. He is in a tricky position because he will be looking at leaving around 10 years of service. As you pointed out, he will be over the hump, so to speak. I left the military much earlier in my career. My first year out, I tripled my pay and saw more of the world than I did when I was in the Navy. I chose to remain in the reserve, but due to the nature of a career at sea, I didn't do much with the reserve. When I finally swallowed the anchor and moved ashore, I discovered that my friends still in the military were making as much money or more than I was, and they were spending less time at sea or away from families to make it. At 10 years of service, he is probably a major. In addition to his base salary, he receives a tax-free housing allowance to cover his living expenses, a subsistence allowance, and probably various special pays and tax advantages. It is very possible that he may experience a pay cut when he leaves the service. definitely if he leaves the service and gets into the airlines, at first anyway. But of course, money isn't everything. What about quality of life? The main reason, actually the only reason I gave up a career at sea was to be with my family. 1 year I spent 11 months on a ship with only sporadic email access and expensive satellite phone service to connect with my family. As an airline pilot, you don't spend that much time away, but as you are well aware, you do end up missing some holidays and, worse yet, children's milestones. What I found when I was going to sea was that family support was virtually non-existent. In the military, however, there is an outstanding family support network to help families deal with the separation. You can comment on how the airlines do this in this regard, but I suspect that this kind of support is hit or miss. Yeah, you're right. This probably sounds like I am arguing that he should stay in the military, but this is not the case at all. The point of my ramblings here is that people in the military, especially officers, have a tendency to underestimate the value of their compensation package, both financial and non-financial. He needs to keep this in mind as he makes his decision. Had I remained on active duty, I would have been eligible for retirement this year. I frequently think, what if, but in hindsight, I don't regret my decision to leave the military, even though financially it may have been better to stick it out for 20 years and collect the lifetime pension, while still be young enough for a second career. But if I'd been at the 10-year point facing that decision, it would have been much, much harder to make. Just as an interesting aside, when I first came ashore, I considered using my GI Bill benefits for flight training and becoming an airline pilot. I felt it would satisfy my wanderlust and while getting me home to my family more often. I even took a few flight lessons. Then 9/11 happened and I saw the airline pilot furloughs and thought maybe it wasn't the best career option after all. Thank you for your wonderful podcast. I discovered it a few months ago and listen regularly. The one bit of feedback I'd give, which is contrary to most of the other feedback you seem to get, is that your podcast is just a bit long. I know, Carl, it is. I listen to about a dozen regular podcasts weekly, but my commute is very short, so it's hard to fit them all in. I manage with APG because yours is so good, but please don't go any longer. Thanks, Carl. Well, thank you, Carl, for sending me in the feedback. And, you know, I agree. It's a long show, but I want to get in everybody's feedback, like yours. And sometimes it just takes a while to answer the feedback. But in your case, luckily, it's not something I really have to answer. It's your opinion and advice for the person that was asking me for advice regarding whether to stay in the military or get out and try to fly for the airline. So you make a lot of good points there. And you know what? The pay these days for, in the United States anyway, for military officers is very comparable to the pay that we are now getting in the major airlines. So, and you make a good point that there are a lot of tax advantages and other allowances that you get you have to factor in. So. And support is just awesome in the military, bar none. So thank you again, Carl, for your advice. And hopefully the gentleman that was seeking my advice for staying in or getting out is listening, and he'll benefit from your sage wisdom. Is that redundant? I think it is. Luke writes, I'm an aviator from the EU, also consider myself to be an air safety geek, and I've just thought of sharing some of my thoughts and comments about your last show. Of course, I'm not sure which show he's talking about. He's probably talking about the Asiana episode, which was, what, 70? I don't remember. 77, I think. Let's see. You may find it worth reading. I'd be happy if you do. If not, feel free to just disregard this email. Too late. I'm already reading it. I'm interested in what happens in the USA in terms of aviation, and I find your show and references to be of immense value. I have been listening to your podcast for some time now, and I really like the video version. Please keep it on. Okay. So, hi. Hi, Luke. Just to let you know, we in Europe are also very concerned with the Asiana 214 incident. The threat about the crash at the Professional Pilots Rumor Network, PPRUNE, forum, mainly a meeting place for European and Australasian pilots, have gathered over 1.1 million views, and of course by now probably way more than that. The explanation of why the auto throttles did not kick in by a PPRUNE user you have cited in your show seems to be spot on to me too. A friend of mine sent me an excerpt from a 777 FCOM. That must be a flight crew operations manual. He says, I'm not 777 rated. And in the pitch envelope protection chapter, it says the following. Quote, when the pitch mode is FLCH or TOGA, I think that stands for flight change or takeoff go around mode, or the airplane is below 400 feet above the airport on takeoff or below 100 feet radio altitude on approach, the auto throttle will not automatically engage. It just might explain the piece of the puzzle if they were in FLCH. A lot was out of the ordinary on that flight, most of which you already briefed in your show, such as the pilot flying had been undertaking initial operating experience. The training captain had the first training flight, and they've never flown together. What I've learned occurs commonly in accidents, things that were not as usual when a flight took off. Yep, that's true. Another thing is that for the past 8 years, the pilot flying had been a captain on the Airbus 320. The A320, although fundamentally similar to the 777, the truth is all modern transport category airplanes are built around a common standard. The A320 has autoflight systems that operate differently. There are no flight change or FLCH, CLB con, which is, I guess, climb, I don't know what that means, climb constant, VNAV or LNAV push buttons in Airbuses. I don't know about the MD-80, though. No. We do have VNAV. In the Airbus, flight envelope protection kicks in whether you like it or not, no matter what the autopilot autothrottle mode you are flying in. I am confident when I say if they flew an Airbus 330 to San Francisco that day, the crash wouldn't have happened, or at least for that reason. Visual, oral, and finally physical protection would have saved the aircraft. I'm not a pro Airbus, and I'm not saying that the A330 is safer than the 777, but I do know what would an Airbus do in such a situation. And just thinking maybe the captain was too used to one thing, like the A320. Of course, this is all assuming the pilot error and bad airmanship took place. Maybe there were some technical malfunctions. We don't know yet. An interesting bit, almost every pilot who's worked in Asia I've spoken with told me that Asian pilots are very keen on using automation, much of it, but this time they couldn't have. The NTSB is doing an outstanding job. They just had another briefing a few hours ago. Again, remember, people, this is Jeff speaking. I received this email quite some time ago, like the 11th of July. So it's a little bit aged. So back to Luke's feedback here. He's talking about the NTSB YouTube page where you can get updates on the investigation, which I also mentioned at the beginning of this episode when I was talking about the crash yesterday of the UPS Airbus 330 in Birmingham, Alabama. Again, great place to go. And he sends a link to the NTSB YouTube page, and it's youtube.com/user/ntsbgov/videos. Of course, probably a lot easier just to go to Google and put in YouTube and then put in NTSB, and then you'll be taken to the NTSB's channel on YouTube. I see that they do media reports every day. You've mentioned how you've been surprised with the amount of engagement of the NTSB and media with this particular accident, and I could also see it. I think it's because high-profile accidents like this one do not really occur every day, thank goodness. One of the biggest modern USA-manufactured airplanes, one of the largest USA airports, even unfortunate two fatalities, of course now we know it's three, all contributed to it. So back to today's NTSB report, they revealed that in the last 2.5 minutes the autopilot cycled through multiple modes. Maybe it stuck in the one that did not include automatic operation of auto throttles. I don't know, just guessing. And what I find interesting is the crew haven't been given a clearance to land until 600 feet radio altitude. They had to contact the tower twice. I understand this might be common at SFO, although I still consider being stable and established on the final 1,000 feet is critical to a safe landing. I agree, Luke. How and why did the training captain let the aircraft full of people slow down to 103 knots when the VREF was 137 is out of my understanding. To me, the only probable explanation would be a display error or pitot failure. I do not see how three pilots in the cockpit with a combined flight time of around 28,000 hours did not notice the speed falling that much and the aircraft not making a thing to warn them about it. If I recall correctly, the training captain even said at one moment to the pilot flying to pull the nose up when he realized that they were too low on the approach with the speed already in the red and throttles at idle. I mean, basic airmanship, basic flying. Right on, Luke. Oh, just some of my rant. Hope you don't mind. That will be all it for now. I would like to thank you for reading this much. I wish you happy contrails and maybe writing to you again, Luke. Thank you, Luke. And yes, I agree with everything in there. A lot of things that could play a part in the reason why they crashed. And as we know now, there were no technical problems with the airplane. So again, they have not come out with a probable cause yet, but it certainly does point to inattention to flying basics like your airspeed. So, again, thanks, Luke, for your feedback. All right, Lee in New Jersey writes, I realize your inbox may be flooded, so if you don't have time to read this on your podcast or respond, I completely understand. Everybody's apologizing for the feedback. But, hey, that's really what the show is about, right, is answering your feedback. And I'm not going to whine about it anymore. I'm just going to do my best to read it all as best I can. So, I have a couple of questions about some hypothetical avionics safety systems that, to an aviation outsider such as myself, it would seem to make a lot of sense for airliners to have, and they don't appear to have now. Over the past 30 years, there have been many deadly accidents where pilots didn't set the flaps for takeoff. The configuration warning systems failed to sound in the cockpit, and the aircraft crashed on takeoff because of this, including three on aircraft types that you've flown or fly now: Northwest Airlines in Detroit in 1987, a Delta Airlines in Dallas in 88, that was a 727, and Span Air in Madrid in 2008, and that was an MD-80 series, I believe. Is there ever any reason you deliberately take off with the flaps retracted? No. If not, wouldn't it make sense to, in addition to the audible cockpit warnings, have a system that wouldn't let the engine spool up for takeoff power when the aircraft was stationary and the flaps were retracted? There are cars now where alcoholics have to pass a breathalyzer test right at the steering wheel for the ignition to start the car. Why couldn't they do this for flaps and takeoff? Do any aircraft have this feature or something similar already? That's a good question, Lee. I don't know. I don't think so. There have been also many accidents where pilots stalled the plane at low altitudes while on approach, and by the time the stick shaker went off, it was too late to recover the airplane, like the Turkish Airlines in Amsterdam in 2009, Continental Express in Buffalo in 2009, and the Asiana accident. Is there ever any reason you would deliberately want to stall a plane at very low altitudes? No. If not, wouldn't it make sense to have an autothrottle system that would prevent the aircraft from stalling at low altitudes for specific flap settings, or something that would be, that would at the very least give audible messages to the pilots in a similar way to the TCAS alerts? Some cars now have systems that automatically apply the brakes when the car is about to hit the car in front of them. Why couldn't airliners have a similar system to prevent low altitude stalls? Do any aircraft have this feature already? Well, as Luke mentioned, the Airbus, the 320 series and a 330 series, and probably the 380, and I'm guessing the 340. Many of the Airbus airplanes do have that protection built in. The airplane won't let you stall it. Of course, unless the computers and the airplane stop working and give you the airplane and without what they call direct or normal law. No, normal law. I'm not an Airbus pilot, so I'm going to mess this up. So anyway, basically, if everything is working properly, the airplane on an Airbus airplane will not let you stall or do any of these things that take you outside a certain flight parameter. However, as we know, Air France Flight 447 in 2009 over the Atlantic Ocean, the computer systems basically didn't like the data that they were being fed and basically said, this does not compute, and they turned off and basically gave control of the airplane to the pilots in the cockpit, and of course, we know what happened in that case, which was a different issue, of course. So, but you make some good points, Lee, in New Jersey. It is human nature for pilots to have lapses of attention, but it seems rather shocking that for all the sophisticated flight management systems, there was none that prevented the Spanair MD-82 that was built in 1993 from taking off with its flaps retracted. Likewise, there was no system that alerted the pilots or prevented the Asiana 777 that was built in 2005 from slowing down below the stall speed. I fault the aircraft manufacturers more than the pilots for these predictable and completely avoidable accidents. What do you think? I disagree. I do not fault the aircraft manufacturers more than pilots, because that's why we're pilots. We're up there to make sure that the aircraft systems are functioning properly and to keep the flight path safe. So I'm not saying that the aircraft manufacturers don't have some blame in some of these accidents, but I can't say that it's entirely their fault. I think that the humans that are up there either manually flying the airplane or monitoring the automation systems are the ones that are ultimately at fault for letting these things happen. No excuse. So that's what I think. We do have systems to prevent. We have takeoff warning systems that let us know when something is not set properly for takeoff. But like all systems, there are ways to fool the system, to thwart the system, to render the system useless. And in many of these cases, that's what happened. I know that the Northwest Airlines incident in Detroit in 87, I think there was some kind of a circuit breaker pulled. And the reason for that was human nature. Anytime you advance both throttles in the airplane, it initiates the takeoff warning system, which, by the way, I'll be playing a recording of in another email that I'll read. But you have to know there are ways to keep that from happening. If you only use one throttle, I do this all the time. If you are advancing the power only on one engine and you leave the other one at idle, you're not going to get that takeoff warning horn. So I know how to keep the thing from, it's annoying when it goes off and you're taxiing around, especially when you're taxiing in. So there's no reason to use the circuit breakers as a switch. And that's what I think happened in the Northwest MD-80, whatever it was they were flying, 82, 80 series. They pulled the circuit breaker for the takeoff warning horn. So they prevented it from doing its job. So the system that you're talking about installing, like, you know, not letting them take off without the flaps set for takeoff. Again, I don't think there's a foolproof way to keep it from happening. We have a policy now at ACME where we're not allowed to taxi an airplane unless we have extended the flaps to either the unknown takeoff flap setting or at least a default takeoff flap setting, so that we don't mistakenly initiate a takeoff roll without the flaps in the takeoff position. So that's a pretty effective way to manage this this problem. This problem. So anyway, I do appreciate your comments, Lee, and keep listening. And as I said in a later piece of feedback here, you're going to hear the takeoff warning horn system in the MD-80 series at Acme. This is from Dan. Hello, Captain Jeff. I'm sure you're still catching up on past feedback, but listening to the latest episode where you spoke about the Asiana flight 214, I just wanted to tie this together with the new rules for first officers, 1,500 hours and so on and so forth. Personally, what I think would be more effective than raising the minimum from 250 to 1,500 hours for first officers would be to make it a requirement for professional pilots, line pilots, charter, etc., to fly a minimum number of hours in a month as manual rather than monitoring automation. For example, for every 10 hours you fly, one of them must be done manually. This is just an example and not necessarily what I would suggest, but I would like to hear your thoughts on this anyway. And this way the pilot gets to choose when and how they do the manual flying. I look forward to your response and safe flying, Dan. I don't know if that would work or not, Dan. You know, like specifying a certain amount, like a ratio of the hour. Maybe it would. I don't know. We've got to do something. I mean, the FAA put out that safety alert for operators back in January of this year. At Acme, I saw a little blurb in one of the communications. Hey, you should be out there manually flying more. And that was it. And that was from our safety department. Operationally, I haven't noticed any difference. I try to set an example of hand flying the airplane when it's appropriate, and I just hope that through my example that the people at least that I fly with will start thinking, hey, it's probably a good idea to keep up the flying skills. But until it comes down from on high, from our operations personnel at Acme, you know what, Dan? You might be onto something. It may be something that's going to be like regulated, like you must fly one out of every 10 hours, 10% of the time, hand fly the airplane when it's appropriate. I don't know. That may be what it takes. But I think it's just this culture that we've slid into over the years, and it's hard to reverse that trend and go back the other direction. And people like me and people that are listening to my show out there that are doing the same thing, trying to instill the importance of hand-flying the airplane at times just to practice your basic skills. It's going to take time, I think, for this to happen. It should have happened years ago. We should never have let this thing go this far, but it has. We have let it go this far, and now we just have to try to do our best to get it going in the right direction. So thanks, Dan, for your suggestion. I don't know if you're listening out there, if you're a airline pilot or a corporate pilot or even general aviation pilot, what do you think? I know general aviation pilots in general, no pun intended, most general aviation airplanes, as far as I know, are manual flying airplanes anyway. And the whole point of flying in general aviation, to me anyway, is getting up there and flying. You know, I can understand in doing this as a business like I do, or a corporate or airline flying. You know, this is what we do for a living, and I understand using the automation and kind of getting complacent and lazy and everything else because you do this a lot every month. If I had a private airplane that I went out, I wouldn't put an autopilot in it unless I was using it for long. You know what I mean? I would go up there just to hand fly the airplane. That's, to me, the whole point of it. But I don't know. I welcome your commentary. What do you think? Am I all wet on this? Let me know. Erica. Hey, you know what? I don't get a lot of feedback from females, and I've already had one from Laura, and now we have Erica. Thank you, ladies, for chiming in. Of course, Liz from Washington, she sends me a lot of feedback. So, but I think the percent, of course, this is true with all podcasts. Podcasts seem to be, for some reason, like a guy thing for the most part, as opposed to other areas of social media like Pinterest. that seems to be a pretty much a girl, a lady, a female thing for the most part. So I don't know why, but I'm glad that there are some females out there listening and contributing feedback like Erica here. Hello. This is such a privilege. I just want to start by saying I really, 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 did I mention really? Well, I really like your show. Hey, thanks, Erica. I kept asking where I have been that I've never seen the show before. Currently, I'm playing catch up with your podcasts. My dad, now with the Lord, used to work for an airline in Africa where I was born, and I was sent to school in the UK, and now I'm a resident here, thus the interest in aviation. Okay, here. Where is here? Here, maybe in the United States? I don't know. The funny thing is, the older I have gotten, the more the desire to fly aircraft. I always liked them, the engineering aspect and how they worked and followed through with magazines, etc. I wanted to work for an airline, but the problem was I wanted a role that combined being part of the flight, but also being part of the engineering. And for years, I thought that that just never existed till one day when I saw an article on pilot training. Then the penny finally dropped. Pilot. That's it. Right. I'm going to finish listening to 71, episode number 71. God bless you, Captain. Kind regards, Erica. And then, I have another piece of feedback from Erica as well. Hello again. I trust this finds you very well indeed. I am still enjoying and catching up on your podcasts. Very educational and informative. Okay, this is Jeff speaking here. I think I've figured out she's not in the U.S. She is writing. I can almost hear the British accent in her writing and the way she uses her grammatical construction. Is that right? Grammar? In other words, I can tell you're not in the United States. You're still over in the UK, right? Am I right? Okay. One question, or rather, I sure would like to hear your thoughts on this. If an airline advertises for new recruits up to the age of 55, and this would include career changers, what would they have to gain when it appears that most other airlines recruit younger new recruits? They are also going to train them for a healthy sum. I do not have a problem with this as I fall in the older bracket, quite away from 55, but not 20. I think it's a great idea. Again, you have a wonderful show, and your voice in pod 66 did not sound bad, just a little huskier. Oh, that was when I had the allergies that affected my voice. Thanks, Erica. Again, for your feedback. And what do I think about, you know, I don't know. I think it's kind of interesting as well that they'd be willing to look at somebody as old as 55. I mean, that's ancient. I mean, I'm not quite 55 yet. I will be in December. Oh, really? Hey, you know what? I got to look on the bright side. Here in the United States, at least, when you hit 55, you're eligible for a lot of senior discounts. Hey, I could take advantage of that. So again, that's looking at the glass half full, not half empty. So yeah, I'm almost at the 55. And why would somebody want to hire somebody that old when they're only going to get, well, if they're going to be an airline pilot, they're only going to get 10 years at the most from somebody who is 55 years old. But maybe they've done all the analysis of the data and find that even with the cost of training an airline pilot for their company, that it still makes economic sense to hire somebody even as old as 55. But it does seem to make much more sense to hire the young people, the 20-year-olds and 25-year-olds and 30-year-olds, because you're going to get a much longer, you know, number of years out of them over their career. I don't know. Good question, though, Erica. Thank you. And again, thanks for listening, and thanks for taking part in the show. I appreciate that. Okay, I have some feedback from Nassau in the Bahamas. Hello, Jeff. I've just recently discovered your podcasts and now consistently have your smooth voice on my headphones. My smooth voice in your headphones. I really enjoyed listening to you, and you give me guidance as I tackle my private pilot's license. Of course, I donated you a cup or two of coffee. Thank you, Wolf. Yeah, I remember that. I appreciate that. I have a question. Have you found yourself on live ATC before? Would you have a link? I would like to know how you sound on the ATC. Anyway, love the show. Cheers from Nassau. A lot of the places I fly into, Wolf, are some of the places that liveatc.net has scanners. Boston, New York, you know, every time I go into Kennedy, I'm not sure. I think they have some feeds from LaGuardia, but I know for sure Kennedy. We're hearing that all the time. I'm not sure if Atlanta has any of the feeds yet or scanner feeds on liveatc.net. But, Baltimore was another one. I actually listened to myself once departing. But, you know, I have to be careful, Wolf, because, you know, when I'm talking on the radio, I am using my real company's call sign. And you'll remember that I work for a fictitious airline, Acme, and I don't use that call sign when I'm on liveatc.net. I use the other one, and so I probably won't be. Maybe I can give you a link in private. Well, so if I don't do that in the next couple weeks, then send me an email and remind me to do that, and I'll see if I can. I'll see if I can find a link to some air traffic control communications. But I mean, just pretty much sound like this. That what you're listening to right now, except maybe not as good quality because, you know, it's going over the aviation radio. But anyway, great to have a listener in Nassau, and thanks for your feedback. Christine. Oh, look, another female. Thank you. Hello, Airline Pilot Guy. I'm a recent listener and I'm enjoying your show. I have some questions for you, which you can use as fodder for the program as you see fit. Number one, what is your favorite airplane to fly, including retired birds like the L-1011 or 727? And so I'll answer that first. My favorite airplane to fly was the L-1011, followed closely by the 727. And the C-141 made by Lockheed, the Starlifter in the Air Force, I flew that. I like that airplane. The T-38 was just a super cool. I didn't fly that for a long time. That was advanced undergraduate pilot training in the Air Force, but wow, talking about a slick airplane, very fast airplane, and very maneuverable. Really enjoyed flying that. You know, the T-37, that wasn't a bad airplane. It was really noisy. Didn't go very fast, but it was a great airplane for what they used it for. I think they retired that airplane too. Just about every airplane I've flown has been retired, except for the airplane that I'm flying now, the MD-80 series, MD-90 series, and the T-38, they're actually still flying that one. You know, at first when I started flying the MD-88, I thought, ugh, it's just not a Boeing, it's not a Lockheed. But maybe it's just because I've been flying it for so many years now, it's, I don't know, I like it. I've acclimated to it, and I really... I'm finally in sync with the controls on it because, you know, as you may or may not know, all the other airplanes I mentioned, they have hydraulically powered control surfaces. On the MD-88, MD-90, well, with the exception of the elevator on the MD-90 and the rudders, the ailerons and, let's say the 80, I'm confusing things. On both the MD-90 and the MD-88, the ailerons, you know, the lateral controls, are not powered by hydraulics. They are actually powered by little tabs on the trailing edge of the control surface, on the trailing edge of the ailerons. So when I actually move the controls in the cockpit, cables going all the way out to these tabs to move the tabs that fly the ailerons that fly the airplane. And at first, it's kind of... It's different. It doesn't feel as responsive as the controls in the L-1011 and the 727, for instance. But then after your brain kind of adjusts to the way they operate, it's actually kind of nice because it's just like your Cessna 172 or whatever general aviation airplane. You know, you can feel the pressures on the control surfaces because it's transmitted directly to your hands. and your feet. And so I like that. Now I've acclimated to it. So I guess the short answer is my two favorite airplanes are the ones you mentioned in your question, the L-1011 and the 727. Okay, number two, I was listening to an Eastern Airlines podcast, and they told a story about an old rivalry between Delta and Eastern. In one story, they told of how Eastern pilots radioed about the terrible weather they were experiencing so that the Delta jet behind them would vector around the storm, thereby allowing Eastern to beat them into Atlanta. I know Eastern is long gone, but I wonder if similar professional rivalries still exist between airlines. Do you, do you have or sense biases at certain airports? For instance, United gets preferential treatment in Denver, JetBlue at JFK. Enjoy the show, Christine. Okay. Yeah. Well, you know, I don't know if this is real or just imagined, but we all kind of think that certain airlines are given preferential treatment at certain airports, like especially their home turf. And then there is one airline out there that everybody in every other airline thinks that they get preferential treatment everywhere they go because they're kind of the darling of the media, the so-called low-cost leader. Which is not really true. But again, I don't know how much of it is really true or how much of it is just perceived, maybe misperceived. But that reminds me of a story, and I don't know if this is true or not, but even if it's not true, it's still funny. The story is that years ago, you mentioned Eastern and Delta, up at Washington National, I think this is where the story supposedly took place. A lot of times, you know, with flow control and, you know, ground delay programs and that kind of thing, takeoff slots and landing slots and that kind of thing, you'll end up getting airplanes all bunched up, you know, at the end of the runway. Maybe you've been a passenger in one of these flights where you're just sitting there in the little holding pad at the end of the runway before you take off, and you look to your left and you look to your right and you see all these airplanes just waiting there, and probably the pilots have come on and said, you know, they've given us a takeoff time of, you know, 15 or 20 minutes from now. We have to wait for our slot and that kind of thing. Well, the story goes that, and this is, of course, back probably in the 70s or 80s, when Eastern Airlines and Delta Airlines were always, you know, at each other's neck. I think the control tower asked if, if Eastern was ready to go. And the story goes that the Delta pilot immediately keyed his microphone and said, we're still working on something. We're not ready yet. Go ahead and let the Delta go. But it was the Delta guy that said it. And before the Eastern guy could come in and say, that wasn't us, the tower controller said, okay, Delta, go into position to hold or whatever, you know, and get ready for takeoff. You're next. And so by the time this all transpired, the Delta jet had already jockeyed into position ahead of Eastern, was taking the runway. And the story goes, again, I don't know if this is true or not, but it's funny, that as the Delta jet was going by the Eastern jet, one of the pilots in the Delta jet kind of gave them the single finger salute. And it was like when the Eastern Airlines airplane was head on. So the only people in the Eastern jet that could see the Delta guys giving them the one finger salute were the pilots. And of course, that just infuriated the heck out of the Eastern guys. And so the Eastern guys, in turn, returned the one finger salute. Unfortunately, the Delta jet was broadside, so all of the passengers looking out the window at the Eastern jet could see the Eastern pilots flipping them the bird. And I think even the story says that one of the Delta pilots got on the PA and said, we'd like to thank the Eastern Airlines pilots for allowing us to go, and they're giving us, they're waving at us, or they basically told the passengers to look over there at the Eastern Airlines jet. And of course, all the pilots were were flipping the bird at the airplane, and it was not good PR for Eastern. Again, I probably screwed that story up, but that was something that I'd heard a few times, and it was at least lore in the airline world. So, and it may have been two different airlines. I don't know, but as far as I know, at Acme, we don't have any biases against any other airline. We love everybody, and we go over, we bend over backwards to let everybody do whatever they want because we love you. Now, I don't know. Good question, Christine. Thanks for the feedback. Christopher, with a K, writes from Bergen, Norway. Yes, I'm another one of the Airplane Geeks listeners that started following your show. It bothers me that I didn't discover your podcast before. So after recently listening to the podcast where you visited the Airplane Geeks, I have gone through your show listening to various episodes with the most interesting sounding titles. Oh, really? That's the hardest thing for me to do, is coming up with a title for the show, because a lot of times it really doesn't have much to do with the things I talk about in the show. But I talk about so many things in the show, it's really hard to come up with one topic that was representative of everything that I've talked about. So now you have the pressure's on, Christopher, for me to come up with interesting sounding titles. Your show really fit in the empty space left after what I think is a fellow Acme pilot quitting podcasting. The Fly With Me podcast by Jody Owen was a nice podcast, giving the insight and thoughts of a pilot flying for the majors, but now I finally found a replacement. Thank you. Yeah, Jody Owen had a great show, Fly With Me. And his was, mine's a little bit different than his. I really liked his podcast, by the way. And it's been years since he's had an episode, so I think he just finally stopped doing it. But his was more of an interview kind of thing. He was doing interviews in the cockpit in flight. Don't expect that from me, because I don't want to get in trouble for using an electronic device inside the cockpit. And his was more of recordings of stuff going on the crew van. It was more of a, I don't want to say a gossip related kind of show, but it was more of the personal stuff that goes on with pilot crews, flight attendant crews, layovers, that kind of thing. And as you know, I really don't delve into that very much. That's really not where my show is. It was a great show. He had a very National Public Radio style to his delivery and everything else, and I really appreciated everything he did with his show. And hey, Joe, if you're listening, you should get back into it. You probably miss it, don't you? So anyway, thank you, Christopher, for that. So going back to Christopher's feedback, for us that want to live and breathe aviation, but is only able to live it through your experiences and other fixes in the form of flight simulators and plane spotting trips, it's awesome that you would donate your free time and share your passion. Well, thanks. I'm a real fan of the MD-80 series aircraft, which we do see less and less of here where I live, but it was the backbone of the SAS fleet along with the DC-9 for many years. And they even had a few MD-90s. Now they are just weeks, months away from retiring the final aircraft. A sad day. I believe some of them are going to Acme as spare parts, in fact. I'm glad that the MD-80 has a future in a respectable airline. I have a few questions about your military flying. When you were flying the C-141, did you have one crew you flew with regularly, or was it assigned per mission basis from the squadron? And how was the commander co-pilot role assigned? I assume it is more of a course qualification other than a matter of rank. Did you ever get to visit any of the air bases in Norway on a mission? All the best. Christopher. Let's see. P.S. I understand why you won't reveal the name of your airline, but then again, if you did, we'd never play the fun game, guess the airline, which I always play when airline staff produce material on the internet. Okay. Yeah, it's fun, isn't it? And it's usually pretty easy to figure out, right? But again, I have to do that. Back to your question. In the military. Oh, by the way, I answered Christopher. He knows this if he's listening right now via email. And I told him about the when I was flying the C-141 in the Air Force. I only made it into Norway once, and it was up in the upper, the northern part of Norway, up near the Finnish border. What is it called? Bardufoss, I think, air base up there. And it was just long enough to land, offload some cargo, and refuel. And then we were doing some kind of an exercise. I think we were flying out of Goose Bay in Labrador, one of the provinces of Canada. And, you know, flying back and forth to Norway and other northern European countries. I think it was like Operation Cold North or something like that. We had several different operations we'd do at various times of the year or exercises, and that was one of them. And from what I could see, there wasn't really a lot to see because it was wintertime, and as you would expect in Norway in the wintertime, it was instrument meteorological conditions, and so I really didn't get to see much of the countryside or really even much of the airport. I think they were close to minimums, but I did get to see the terminal at Bardufoss in the inside. I think I bought something from Norway to bring back home. But anyway, beautiful country from what I could see, and half of my heritage is from Norway. My mom's side of the family is Norwegian. My father's side of the family from Denmark. So I'm a kind of a Scandinavian 50-50 mix of Norwegian and Danish. Let's see. Oh, how was the crew assigned on the 141? It was based on qualifications and not so much rank. In fact, the aircraft commander might be a first lieutenant, for instance, and the co-pilot or navigator could be maybe a captain or a major. So it really was the roles were assigned based on your experience and your longevity and your qualifications. If you'd gone to aircraft commander school, et cetera, that kind of thing. Much like the airlines, really. In fact, flying in the military airlift command in the Air Force, back when I was in the Air Force in the 1980s, was very much like flying in the airlines, you know, like a military version of the airlines. Let's see. Yeah, I think I answered all your questions. Thanks, Christopher, for finding the show, and I'm glad you're enjoying the podcast. And as I've mentioned many times, this is, you know, flying is a passion, and explaining, you know, what my job entails to lay people is kind of one of the fun things I like to do. So there you go. Let's move on. Ah, audio feedback. Finally, this is some feedback sent to me from Evert Rinkel, and he is from the Netherlands. And he writes, "Here's my first audio feedback for your great podcast. Here's the link I mentioned in the audio feedback to one of my YouTube videos where you can see a professional 737 add-on in action on the VAT SIM network to give you a bit of an idea of what it's like out there. By the way, VAT SIM stands for Virtual Air Traffic Simulation Network. And you'll be able to see the face behind the voice of this audio feedback. And I did watch... I think I watched most of the video, Evert. Have not finished yet, but excellent job, by the way. The way you did the video with the inset, you know, you could see his face, and then you could see all of what's happening in the simulator or simulated cockpit and everything else. Very, very cool. I mean, man, I wish that there was something like this when I was younger, you know, when I was a preteen and a teenager. Gosh, that would have been a blast. You know, I'm amazed at the detail and the sophistication that these flight simulator programs are giving now. And you know, it's I think it's conceivable that people could be almost completely qualified to fly in an airliner based on just doing stuff in the flight simulator world. Maybe not quite, but a lot more than just reading Flying Magazine. That's all I could do when I was 12 years old or a teenager. So I think this is pretty cool. So let's play Avert Wrinkles feedback. So here, let me push the right button. Where is it? Oh, my. Did I forget to put it in here? Okay, well, I'm going to have to play it right here then.
Hi, Captain Jeff. How are you doing? My name is Avert, and I'm from the Netherlands. Thank you for this wonderful podcast. I really enjoy listening to. They're very informative, and I learn something new every single week. So please keep them coming. I discovered your podcast through a video on Roderick van Hogen's YouTube channel. As you know, Roderick is our national media priest here in the Netherlands. I think you know him pretty well. And he had a video out there of the two of you eating lunch in your car, and he referred to you as Captain Jeff. So I was wondering, is he a pilot? Well, he must be with his aviator mustache and this Captain Jeff thing. So I looked it up on Google, and I found your podcast. So it's maybe not, maybe it's not really a common way to find your podcast, but at least it was fun to discover it through his YouTube video. So I've got two questions for you today. I myself am a desktop simulator pilot using the game Microsoft Flight Simulator 2004. Now, I don't know how much you know about all this, but there's been a lot of development taking place over the last, I think, 10 to 15 years in the flight simulator industry. And it's not really a game anymore. It has truly become a simulator. And that's because we can expand our flight simulator with add-ons, mostly payware add-ons. And by installing these add-ons or software packages, you can fly a real airliner. And when I say fly, of course, you don't really learn how to fly a Boeing 737, for example, because the flying dynamics in the desktop simulator are way different from the real world. But you do know how all the cockpit systems work, for example. You do know how to program the flight management system. You know what all those knobs and switches for, and that's because these airplanes are being recreated in great detail. I'd say 99% accurate to the real thing. And of course, there's a lot of information out there on the internet that will help you understanding and learning how the airplane works. But I'm also flying on the FATSIM network. FATSIM stands for Virtual Air Traffic Simulation Network. It's basically a virtual environment where we can make, us pilots can make our virtual flights from point A to B. But there are also people on the other side, and those are the air traffic controllers, just like the real thing, and they will guide us through the virtual airspace. Now, especially in combination with those payware add-ons, that creates a very realistic environment. Now, I've included a link to one of my videos where I made a flight from Amsterdam on to Vienna using the Boeing 737 on the VATSIM network. So to give you a bit of an idea what it looks like and how professional it can be, we're using real-world procedures. The RT is very professional. New air traffic controllers are really being trained into using real-world procedures and professional RT. I myself am also a ground controller at Amsterdam, and yeah, you get to know lots of stuff you haven't known before joining the VATSIM network. Now, my question was, have you ever heard about it, and what do you think of it? Maybe you heard other pilots at ACME who've used it or still using it. I myself know quite a few people who are now pilots after flying on the VATSIM network for many years, or air traffic controllers as well. And of course, it provides a great opportunity for those who can't become airline pilots to get a bit of a feeling of that making flights with airliners. So please let me know, what do you think of it, and have you ever heard about it? And my second question was, us flight simulator pilots, of course, all have this heroic dream of taking over the airplane when the two pilots in the front become incapable of flying the airplane. Now, though the situation is very unlikely to happen, is there any procedure or protocol at ACME for when the two pilots in the front become incapable of flying the airplane? When there's no pilot on board, of course, but do they really call for flight simulator pilots in the back, or does the cabin crew take over? I'm also curious to hear your answer to that. So these were my two questions. If you ever have a chance to visit the Netherlands, please let me know. We can have some nice Dutch beer with typical Dutch bitterballs. They're very nice, I can tell you. Or if you're coming in the winter season, we can have some coffee and Dutch donuts, also very typical Dutch delicacy that I think you will enjoy very much. So please let me know. For now, thanks again for this wonderful podcast, and I'd like to say bye-bye and God bless from Rotterdam, the Netherlands.
Well, thank you, Evert, for that fantastic podcast. Feedback. Very well done. Very professional sounding. And again, I'll have a link to his YouTube video, one of many that he's done using the VAT sim network, and very professionally done as well. And yes, I do know this this guy named Father Roderick. He is a very good friend of mine, and we work together at the StarQuest Production Network, and I consider him one of my best friends, actually. So he's a wonderful man, and he's often on vacation now in France, I think, with three other priests, and it won't be long before he is on his way to the land down under, to Australia and New Zealand. And I was hoping, actually, to be with him for that 1 or 2 weeks and actually do be his cameraman for some special video series that he was thinking about doing. Unfortunately, my plans changed, and I'm not going to be able to do it. But anyway, this is not the usual way, Evert, that people find my podcast, and I'm glad you found it, though. And I'm glad that you let me know about your little slice of the aviation world. I think I understood you correctly. You said you're a ground controller in real life, and then you also participate in the virtual air traffic simulation network, and then, of course, you do the pilot end of it as well. Through the flight simulator program. And what do I think of it? I think it's amazing. I mean, I was amazed. Hey, if you've never seen this, folks, if you're listening to this or watching this video and you've never seen this in action, please click on the link from Evert, and you're going to be amazed at the realism that is portrayed using the VATSIM network with the flight simulator programs out there. So yeah, you're right, Evert. It's much more than just a game now. So again, if I am in the Netherlands, I would love to do that someday, to visit Roderick on his own turf. And if I do that, I promise I'll look you up, and we'll have some of that great beer and what did you call it? Bitterbit and Dutch donuts. I've heard Father Roderick talk about both of those things. So, yes, I'd love it. And apparently, the Dutch know something about good coffee, too, I hear. Played a big role in the introduction of coffee to the world. Okay, let's get on with another question from Andy. And Andy is from, speaking of Australia, Melbourne, Australia. Currently, I'm learning to fly light sport aircraft, and by far the most challenging part of it for me is short final to flare and holdoff. My instructor tells me that in normal conditions, you should hold off the runway until the aircraft begins to stall and descends the last 1 or 2 feet to the runway. Anyway, my question for you is, how do you land? What is the procedure you go through from short final to all wheels on the ground? You mentioned in episode 74 an interesting thing that I think will help me, airspeed, aim point, airspeed, aim point, airspeed, aim point. In a normal landing, do you hold off until stall or fly onto the runway? Keep up the good work, Andy. In airliners, no. We don't hold the airplane off until it stalls. We always touch down with, you know, some sort of flare, sometimes not much, flaring the aircraft and then allowing the ground effect to kind of help cushion a little bit of the touchdown. And of course, depending on the airplane, if you're flying an airplane that has landing gear trucks, you know, where you have more than just twin tandem wheels, like I have in the 88 and the 727, a lot of the narrow bodies don't, you know, they don't have the trucks where they have like four wheels on each truck or more. 777, I think, has six wheels on each of the landing gear trucks. And I don't know if you noticed this, but coming in on final, you can see that usually those landing gear trucks are kind of at an angle, either the back wheels down farther than the front wheels or vice versa, I think, on some of the Boeings that they're in the other direction. But anyway, this angled kind of posture of the main landing gear trucks really help kind of dissipate some of the impact of the landing or the transition from flying to, you know, being on the runway. So it makes it a little bit easier to get a good landing. The only airliner that I've ever held off until it stalled was was a simulator test that I was given by U.S. Airways. That was one of the airlines that I interviewed with back in the late 80s, and had never flown a BAC 111. And one of the things they told us not to do, they told us several things not to do when we were in the simulator, and I think I did all of them the wrong way. And for some reason, they called me back for another interview, which still escapes me to this day why I was on the list to come back in for another interview. But anyway, I held off the airplane. I pulled the power off way too early because I was used to doing that, because at the time I was flying the T-37 in the Air Force, and in like 50 feet above the ground, we'd pull the power to idle. And you just don't do that in an airliner, or at least most airliners, you don't do that. And I did that in the simulator airplane, and I held it off until it got into the stick shaker, and then we touched down. It was a pretty good landing, actually, but that's a no-no in the airline world. You don't stall just above the runway, in big airplanes, at least. Now, in general aviation, I guess that's not unusual. I'm trying to remember. It's been a long time since I've flown in a general aviation, you know, light aircraft. I do seem to remember, you know, like holding it off and then, you know, kind of hearing that sound, that stall warning horn going off. So I guess, I don't know, general aviation pilots out there listening, is that a good technique that Andy's talking about here? I don't know. What I would say about landings, and I think this is true no matter what airplane you fly, is that the best way to get a, well, if you're flying an airliner and it has an autoland system, just hook up the autoland system and watch how the computer does it. Now, it usually does it a lot differently than we human pilots do, but it kind of gives you some cues as to the way it makes a landing. But as far as applying to every airplane out there, I think the best thing to do, and it's one of the hardest for me anyway to do, is to, because, you know, you're staring at that aim point on the runway, and then when you transition to flaring, it's hard to keep from looking at that runway that's directly ahead of the nose of the airplane. If you can force yourself to shift your eyes up and look at the horizon and look at the opposite end of the runway, the far end of the runway, that gives you more of a gauge as to how quickly you're descending into the runway. And every time I'm able to force myself to shift from looking at the aim point to the end of the runway when I'm in the flare, I always get a really good landing. So that would be my only advice. What do you think out there, you landing gurus out there? What's some good advice for Andy for making a good landing? Come on, I need some help. Okay, thanks for your feedback, Andy, and I'm sorry I'm not going to be in Melbourne, Australia to give you a visit. Okay, where are we here? 1 hour and 48 minutes. Oh, I'm getting close to 2 hours, and I got many, many more things I wanted to play. Okay, let's move on. Pasadena Brian, he starts off, Whiskey Tango Foxtrot? And you know what, Brian, I hope you don't mind. I'm not going to read yours this episode. I'm going to save it. Joseph. No, you know what? Heck, I already started talking about Pasadena Brian's Whiskey Tango Foxtrot feedback. He says, so I'm in Phoenix on business and my afternoon meeting gets canceled. I go to the airport to fly standby on an earlier U.S. Air flight. No problem. It happens all the time. Should be easy, so I think. At the airport, the ticket counter agent tells me it's a $200 change fee plus the difference in fare to fly standby. So for a fee of $527, I can get on an earlier flight. Now, if that wasn't crazy enough, they tell me if my flight was oversold, they would put me on the earlier flight for free. I reminded them if they oversold my flight, they would have to compensate me for selling my flight. They aren't doing me any favors by putting me on an earlier flight for free. They're actually saving themselves money. To add to the insult, she informs me that if I had status on US Air, they would waive all the fees. I tell her I fly on US Air a lot, but I have the miles posted to my United account. She says, that's too bad. So much for the Star Alliance benefits. Is it just me, or is this a WTF moment? Speechless and not wanting to pay $527 to fly home for a few hours early, I take my original ticket and head through security. I go to the standby flight gate, hand the gate agent my ticket, and say, I'd like to get on this flight if possible. Are there any open seats? She takes my ticket, tap, tap, tap on the keyboard, and says, would an exit row seat be okay for you? I say, yes, I'd be able to help in case of an emergency. Thank you very much. The gate agent hands me my boarding pass and says, we are boarding now, and you may board at your convenience. There was no mention of a change fee, no demand to pay a difference in fare, just tap, tap, tap. Here's your boarding pass, sir. I'm telling you, this is just crazy. It reminds me, if you don't get the answer you're looking for, ask someone else. And be nice about it. You just might get what you requested. Fly safely, Pasadena Brian. So, that, you know, isn't that true with life? Just, you know, if you don't get the answer you want, just ask somebody else and just be nice. Be kind. Be pleasant to other people. That's good advice for every aspect of life, I think. Hey, believe it or not, I'm now reading emails from early August, and it's still August. Wow, I'm catching up. This is from Joseph. Hi, Captain Jeff. Love your show. I've always loved flying. My dad was in the Navy for 20 years and got his education paid for by Uncle Sam and became a naval aviator. In hindsight, that is the path that I should have followed, Navy or Air Force. Air Force has much nicer bases. That's true. I graduated in 1992 with a Bachelor of Sciences in Aircraft Systems Management, Commercial Pilot, Single and Multi-Engine Land with Instrument Rating. Let's see, CFI, CFII, Multi-Engine Instructor, staying at the University of North Dakota, and flight instructing was out of the question for me and most of my classmates. I had to start paying back on the loans before I graduated. In hindsight, I should have gotten a basket weaving degree and then applied for flight training in the military instead of flying a truck like I'm doing now. Any suggestions would be appreciated. And this is from Joseph. Graduated in 1992. I graduated in 1981. So that means you're approximately 10 years younger than me. So you're probably somewhere around 43, 44 years old, if I've done my calculations correctly. And you're not a spring chicken, but you're not an old geezer either, Joseph. If you have all these ratings, you didn't say how many hours you had, though. It may be a long road, especially now with the new rules going in effect this month for the 1,500-hour minimum for getting on with a Part 121 carrier. I don't know. I guess it's going to depend on your particular situation, what kind of money, spending income you have to go out there and get, you know, get hours flying. There are so many variables here. I don't know, you know, you have a family, you have children that count on your income. They may be going off to college. You know, you're about that age where your oldest may, if you have children, heading to college soon, if not already. College tuition, let me tell you, I know, it's expensive. And I don't know. I really don't know what kind of advice to give you. I think that if you could get some flying and do some extra flying on the side with, you know, trying to build up your time, it may be doable. I'm not sure how long it would take if you started flight instructing again. You know, by the time you got all the qualifications necessary to get on by an airline, it may be several more years, putting you closer to the 50-year-old mark. I don't know. What do you think, guys out there listening, guys and girls? Do you have any advice for Joseph? I'd love to give him some good advice. So, Joseph, keep listening. Hopefully somebody out there will help me answer your question, because I don't want to tell you the wrong thing, because, you know, I might completely ruin your life, not help it. So I'm sorry I didn't have a better answer for you. That sound clip, by the way, is called Punch in the Gut. That's what I don't want to do. I don't want to punch you in the gut, man. Alan writes, I, like some of your new listeners, found you via the Airplane Geeks podcast. Boy, I wish I was in Oshkosh right now. And, of course, now it's over. As a frequent flyer, Diamond, of my hometown airline, I have a couple of questions for you that I'm sure you can answer. The story. On Sunday, July 27th, I was caught in that debacle of travel to Newark that caused every evening flight to be delayed by hours. My flight was due to leave at 7:40, and I finally left at 10:40. Ugh. We heard stories of the weather and some computer problems at Newark. When we finally left, we flew towards Cincinnati and then turned right towards Newark. Of course, we then drilled a hole in the sky for about 30 minutes, circled, and were finally released from the hold. During this, I asked the flight attendant about her hours. She said if we hadn't taken off by 11:30, they would have timed out, and if we had to land for refueling, which they thought we would have to, they had to take off before 2:30 in the morning to prevent them again from timing out. The question is, so what does timed out really mean? I know it has to do with the FAA rules and regulations, but what are the parameters that the FAA mandates, and does my hometown airline use those rules or enforce stronger ones? Your hometown airline basically enforces the FAA rules and regulations when it regarding flight time limitations. And I'm not sure what the flight attendants' regulations are. I know that they're looser or more flexible than the guidelines are for pilots. And, of course, it depends on the airline and the individual contractual rules and regulations regarding flight time limitations. But I think that your hometown airline, I can speak for the pilots, you know, there's a certain max duty day that those pilots are assigned for a particular day, and then they can voluntarily, actually, the company in unusual or irregular operations can extend that max duty time that's listed on your trip rotation by 2 hours, but beyond that 2 hours, they cannot force you to fly more than that. And so what happens is, if you've been flying, it's been a long day, and toward the end of your day, when you get your paperwork with your flight plan information, there will be a printout or part of the flight plan printout that will say that the pilots have to take off by this time or else they risk flying over the over the Federal Aviation Regulation maximum flying. And so you have to take off before that time, because you have to add the scheduled flying time for that flight to whatever, wherever you are, as far as how long you've been on duty, et cetera. It's actually pretty complicated. I'm kind of simplifying it because there are new nuances to this whole thing. So, you know, it depends on, is this the first day of your trip, or have you already been flying for a couple days and you've had extremely long duty days in the previous couple days and you had minimum crew rest? And so now new rules come into effect. So it's really kind of a very dynamic, flexible kind of calculation. So I really can't give you specifics on, but timing out means basically that you're up against that FAA regulation that specifies the maximum amount of time on duty, including the projected flying time that you're about to leave for. And if for some reason you don't take off by that time, you are required to. You don't even have the choice. Even if you feel sorry for all the passengers on board the airplane and know that they're going to probably cancel the flight and everybody's going to be left in the lurch and many, many people are going to get inconvenienced, we don't have a choice. We have to stop the operation of the flight and go back to the gate and get off the airplane. Hopefully, there's another crew that they can find that still have duty day left that can, you know, take your place in the airplane and fly you to Newark or wherever you're going. But that doesn't always happen. And unfortunately, we can only, you know, do so much before we turn into pumpkins like Cinderella. And the glass slipper, you know, the whole thing. So, and that's happened a few times in my career at Acme, where we timed out. We had to actually, you know, pack up our stuff, get off the airplane, and left all the passengers sitting there in the airplane, just staring at us like, "Where are you going?" And you know, having to explain to them that we cannot fly the airplane anymore. And so I always hate to see that because I know what a great inconvenience that is for the passenger. But that's just the way the rules are. Again, I wish I could give you more details, you know, what the exact parameters are. But needless to say, it's usually something around on a non-augmented crew, like a non-international flight. It's something in the 14 to 16 hour range, or I think approximately. That's a long day. It really is. So, you know, you start off the day at, you know, 5 o'clock in the morning showtime, and it's, what, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It's getting to be 10 or 11 o'clock at night, and you've been on duty since 5 o'clock in the morning. That is a long day. I mean, come on. You know, as a passenger, just sitting there in the airplane for a 3-hour flight is fatiguing. Now, multiply that by several flights, and then, you know, at the end of that time, and you're pretty fatigued, and there's a reason why the FAA has these rules that say, I'm sorry, as much of a good guy or a good girl you are, and you want to help everybody and help move the operation, we're not going to let you do it. Because you could, as good as you feel, you're probably not at 100%. You're probably not even at 70%. Maybe you're 50% as far as your intellectual capacity at that point and physical capacity. So this is all for safety, and unfortunately sometimes it results in cancellations and major inconveniences for passengers. All right, let me see, what else do we want to talk about here? Oh, advanced entitlement. I listened to a publicly available podcast from my hometown airline, and recently they have talked about advanced entitlement to the 717s they are getting and to all other slots due to retirements, etc. I assume this is for pilots to move from existing aircraft types to new aircraft types or from right seat to left seat. Yes, that is the case. Why is it called advanced entitlement as such? I know that being a pilot is different than working in that you don't get promoted to a new aircraft type, but is this the way of advancing your career? And in general, yes, this is the way. Now, you know, it's used by us in different ways, like to move from one crew base to another base. It may not be actually an advancement in you know, status or an advancement in pay, or it may be an advancement or a better improvement in your life going to a different base or maybe flying a different airplane. It could be in general, it's usually going to a bigger airplane with more pay, or maybe, as you said, moving from the right seat to the left seat, which is a big pay raise. And yes, that is the way we advance in our careers. It could also be used the other way. You could go, you know, I'm a really junior captain on this airplane. I think I'd rather go back to being a senior crew member on something. So I'm going to put in a request to be go from a captain to a first officer. So a captain in a narrow body to a first officer in a big jumbo international kind of airplane. And for about the same amount of money, maybe a little bit less money as a first officer, but your seniority goes way through the roof and you have a lot more control over your life. So some people use advanced entitlements for that purpose. In that case, it may be called a displacement, really. Either a voluntary displacement or, as has happened to me in the past when I was in the 727, they were retiring the airplane and they were shrinking the number of captains on the airplane in Atlanta. And guess what? My number came up. I was mandatorily displaced. And I had a preference for, okay, if you're going to bump me off this airplane, this is where I want to go. This base, this equipment, this position. And that's how I got bumped off the 727 to the MD-88 back in 2002, I think. So it's used for that. That's the way we move around, either from different bases, different airplanes, different positions, or a combination of all those. Okay, I don't, and that's, you know, the way it works at Acme anyway, and your hometown airline and other major legacy airlines were pretty much all the same in that regard in the United States. I don't seem to get on the MD-88-90 much. Newark is a mix of planes. O'Hare is DC-9s. Talk about old. Salt Lake City is 767s. Vancouver is the CRJ Embraer. Also, most of my flying is Sunday and Thursday, so with your usual schedule, I don't think I'll find you up front. But I look for your mug name when I get on one. I'm flying on one or two round trips next week to Baltimore Washington International, though, and I'll keep a lookout. When did he send this to me? This was back on the 2nd of August. Yeah, I get in and out of Baltimore, Washington International, BWI, quite often. So, yeah, keep looking. You never know. The people here tell me that Sully's plane came to a rest right in front of the building I'm in. Too bad I wasn't here then. Must have been something. But then again, the people had to live through 9/11 right out their front door, too. Yeah. By the way, I do find the 3 hours to be a bit much, but I do appreciate your time and answering all the questions you get. 3 hours? I don't think I've ever had a 3-hour show, have I? Maybe this one will be. Where am I now? Ooh, I'm over 2 hours. Sorry. Let's see. You, though, may want to plead email overload and just clean out your mailbox and start fresh. But hopefully not before you answer my email. Ah, Alan, I wish you had given me that advice earlier and I would have just deleted your email. Yeah, you got through the you slipped through the crack, Alan. Thanks for your feedback. I do appreciate it. Hope I answered everything you asked. Okay, wow. There are several audio feedbacks that I wanted to play. I'm going to do at least a couple of them here. It's going to be a longer show, I'm sorry. But, you know, hey, the great thing about podcasting, now maybe you watching the video right now are going, I can't do this. But, you know, you can always come back and watch the rest of the show later. If you're listening to the audio podcast, just put it on pause. And then if you think about it later, you can listen to the rest of the show. If not, just... you can catch up on the next episode. But Tim Brown writes, "Hi, Captain Jeff. Just started listening to your podcast. I'm working my way through the past episodes. I have a question about wind shear. I was listening to John F. Kennedy ATC on liveatc.net the other day, and I was hearing the tower controller report an automated wind shear alert of 25 knots gain at, I think he said, a three-mile final. He was asking for pilot reports who are reporting like 10 knots at 900 feet. My question is, oh, he said that some of the pilots were reporting 10 knots at 900 feet. My question is, number one, where does the automated wind shear alert come from? Is it on an aircraft or some kind of sensing equipment at the airport? It's on the airport. Many airports have this, it's called LLWAS, Low Level Wind Shear Alert System, or alerting system. And next time you're at or near an airport, look around and you'll see these towers along the perimeter. I don't know what the spacing is, maybe a mile or two apart. And usually, you know, not right on the airport property, but near it on the perimeter of the airport. And they kind of look like cell phone towers. They remind me of those things, but they're not. They're special instrumentation to sense changes in air flow and velocity and direction, which is flow. These things come up with and compare the wind direction and speeds at this location with the wind direction and speed at a different location, and then they come up with, I guess they feed it all into a computer system, and the computer system goes, I think I'm experiencing a wind shear in this quadrant. And then the tower controller will say, you know, wind shear alert, low-level wind shear alert, you know, so-and-so gain or loss at so-and-so altitude, whatever. So it's an on-the-ground system. Why the large difference between the report and the actual effect? Well, these things are, they're on towers, so they're up in the air, but they're not as high as the airplane is. And the air flow, just a couple hundred feet above where the sensors are in the ground, can be quite a bit different than the flow that they're experiencing. So that's one difference. The dynamics of the airplane moving through the dynamic flow of air, it just has a different effect. But at least it's something to give us an idea when we're in a situation where we really, really need to be aware that we could experience a wind shear. So if somebody's getting a low-level wind shear alert, and depending on the conditions, you know, if you're looking at this super, you know, mean-looking convective cell pretty close to the airport, and you're getting the airport's low-level wind shear alert system giving alerts, this might be a time that you say, you know what, I think I'm going to go ahead and initiate a go-around and let this whole thing die down a bit before I attempt to get really close to the ground, moving in a very large, heavy metal tube about to touch down. And so, you know, you may say, maybe this is a time to do the right thing, the safe thing, and initiate a go-around. Or, you know, you may continue and looking at the situation, thinking that must be a momentary thing, and based on the stability of my airplane and the fact that I'm not receiving any low-level, I mean, any wind shear alerts in my airplane, maybe I can continue. Again, it's going to depend on the airline and their operating and procedures, et cetera. But it's just an aid, a tool that we have to alert us to a possible risk. Why the large difference between the... Oh, I already answered that. How do you, as a pilot, prepare for this? It would seem that if you had a 10-knot gain below 1,000 feet, you would have to go around as the aircraft would not be stabilized. Well, honestly, again, it depends on the actual episode or instance that you're experiencing this. A 10-knot gain in itself is not a big deal. If it's really bobbing around 10 knots either side of your reference speed or 20 knots or more, and you're feeling a lot of turbulence associated with it, and you're also getting, you know, low-level wind shear alerts, et cetera, that's when it's time to get the airplane away from the ground and go somewhere to hold for a while, let the system blow through, or head to your alternate airport. Again, it's kind of a fluid thing. And then we do have... some of our airplanes have reactive wind shear systems. The one that I fly does, and it's a let me read you a little bit of, from my manual. The aircraft must enter an actual wind shear area before the system can provide any wind shear alerts. The wind shear alerting and guidance system provides detection, alerting, and guidance through hazardous wind shear. The wind shear computer receives attitude, acceleration, and other data from the digital flight guidance computer, the central air data computer, and the flight director and stall warning computers. The wind shear computer also interfaces with the central oral warning system, the CAWS, for our oral and vocal wind shear alerts. And so basically, the airplane that I fly, there's a computer that receives input from all these systems and can sense when you're getting into a situation where the airplane's not stable, and you're what it determines is you're approaching a wind shear situation, which is dangerous. And then it will it'll start making noise like this.
Wind shear.
Like that. That female voice. Wind shear. When you see that, and you also get some flashing red lights or yellow lights, depending on whether or not it's a increasing performance or a decreasing performance kind of a shear event. And usually you're going to end up getting both events. But the dangerous one, of course, is the decreasing performance. And that's when you get the red flashing light and wind shear guidance comes into play. And after a certain amount of time and the computers get all synced up, you actually get some guidance with your flight director bars and kind of get an idea where to put the nose of the airplane. And of course, you know, put the power on. If you think you're about to hit the ground, you know, you go to maximum, or what we call firewall power, which is higher than normal takeoff power, even max power. I mean, it's like, I'm about to hit the ground and I don't care if I destroy the engines. I need every ounce of power I can get out of these things. And so that's when you just extend the throttles all the way to the firewall and hope that you have enough power to get away from the ground before you hit it. So a lot involved with wind shear, reactive wind shear systems and wind shear recovery techniques and maneuvers to get away from the ground and into safety again. I wanted to talk more about it. We even have a predictive wind shear system on the MD-88. That scans using the radar weather ahead and the projected flight path, and can to give you a warning, you know, well before you're in a situation where you're experiencing wind shear. And that's a pretty cool system as well. But perhaps I'll have time to talk about it a little bit more on a future podcast. But I just wanted to get that one out of the way. And let's see, there was one other that I wanted to make sure I played. Oh, David wrote, big fan of the podcast. I've listened to it from Hong Kong for the last year. Keep up the good work. Thanks, David. I was in the U.S. recently flying from San Francisco to John F. Kennedy on a United. Well, he's a 737-200, but I don't think that United is flying any 737-200s anymore. It's probably a different model. We taxied out to the runway, went to takeoff thrust, and before long reduced thrust and pulled off the runway for a rejected takeoff. The captain came over the PA to announce that the reason that we didn't take off was that the spoilers were deployed and that this wasn't normal for takeoff. Further, he mentioned that they cranked the handle to reset the spoilers and were ready to take off again. So my question is, at what point during the flight would spoilers normally be used, and why do you think that they would be deployed on takeoff? Is it an easy thing to overlook? And thirdly, when they say they crank the handle, what is really happening in the cockpit? Appreciate the hard work you do to put in the podcast, and we learn something new every time we listen. Okay. Well, I've never flown the 737, so I'm not sure exactly what their systems do and when things are supposed to happen and all that kind of stuff. But just in generalities, I can say that you don't want to take off with the spoilers deployed, because spoilers spoil lift, and you want lift when you're taking off. What likely happened was, as they were applying power, they probably have a takeoff warning system, as we do in the MD-80 series, that checks for a bunch of different things. It checks to see, and we talked about this earlier in the show about taking off with the flaps set in the proper takeoff position. It checks for if the spoilers are deployed, if various things are not where they're supposed to be. And this is what it sounds like. Now, here we go.
Flap. Flap. Stabilizer. Brakes. Spoilers. Landing gear.
Okay, those are some of the warnings that you might hear. Not all of those are in the takeoff warning system. Obviously, the landing gear, you know your landing gear is down because you've been taxiing around before you take off. But several of those things are part of the takeoff warning system, and something is not where it's supposed to be. So that's when you kind of pull the power back. You know, this is very early in the takeoff roll, before 80 knots. You know, when you pass 80 knots, generally you're in the higher speed rejected takeoff realm, and that's pretty serious. But in the from 0 to 80 knots, you're in the lower speed regime, and this normally happens as soon as you put the throttles up to a certain point position. And if something is not right in the logic, then you'll start getting some kind of a warning like this. So that's probably what happened in your flight. They probably pushed the power up, and then it said spoilers, you know, beep beep, spoilers. So they pulled the power back to idle and rejected the takeoff. Nothing dangerous there, but obviously something is not in the proper position. And sometimes the way all these systems interact with each other, it may be just a little nudge of one of the little dials, or the way that you set certain things in the airplane. And when he said they cranked the handle, they probably pulled the little manual hand crank handle. There's a, in the Boeings, they have this, or most of the Boeings anyway, they have a wheel, a trim wheel up there, and they probably pulled out the handle, cranked the handle. In other words, they moved the spoiler handle to a, actually, you know what? They probably weren't even talking about the spoilers. They may have been talking about the stabilizer. That's what I'm talking about, cranking the handle for the stabilizer. Stabilizer trim has to be in a certain range for takeoff, and it has to kind of match with the center of gravity that you've set and the flap setting, etc. And if it's not within, you know, a certain tight parameter, then you're going to get some kind of a warning. So I bet that's what he said. He probably didn't say spoilers, or if he did, he didn't. He probably meant to say stabilizer. Maybe the stabilizer trim setting was not in the proper position, or it was really close to being out of position, so they just kind of adjusted or cranked the stabilizer trim wheel a little bit, and then got the system to like it, and then they took off and everything was hunky-dory. Again, this is all speculation. I don't know exactly what he was talking about. Now, if he really was talking about cranking the spoiler handle, I don't know, because the spoiler handle kind of moves like a lever in most airplanes, where you kind of pull it out to extend or deploy the spoilers, and then you move it forward to stow the spoilers. Maybe he meant that they deployed and kind of exercised the spoiler handle to make the system happy with the fact that the spoilers were, you know, flush and in the proper position for takeoff. I don't know. That's a good question. I don't really have a good answer, I guess. But I just wanted to play the takeoff warning horn system on the MD-88, because I went through the hassle of recording that. So anyway, David, hope I got close to an answer for your question. And keep listening. Thanks for your feedback. And let's see, Ken, the RJ captain for ExpressJet, he sent me a nice long audio feedback, like 10 minutes long. I'm not going to play that because we're already at 2:22. We're already beyond where we should be for the show. I still have Doug, Ken. Oh, I just talked about Ken. Bart and Alex sent audio feedback. And I'm sorry, guys. I didn't get to it in this episode, but I promise I'll play it in the next one. And several of you also sent me just regular email feedback. And that's going to have to wait for the next one as well. I'm sorry. Darn it. Huh. I'll just quickly, let me knock this one out from Mariana on Twitter. She said, She sent this message that looks like Asiana Airlines is offering cash to the crash survivors, $10,000 each. And she said it's probably not going to keep them from suing. They're going to sue anyway. But anyway, oh, good. I got that one out of the way. Can check that one off the list. But anyway, Chris and Keith and PJ, Xandrew, Manny, Sam, John, Doug, Bart, Alex, Anthony, Tim, Eric, Keith, all of you. Just hang in there. Again, hopefully we'll get your feedback knocked out on the next episode. And so I guess that just means now we're going to have to go over here to my outro. You, too, can send feedback. Don't send me too much. By sending it to feedback at airlinepilotguy.com. You can go to 304-99-PILOT, 304-997-4568. Or go to my website, Airline Pilot Guy. Hit the send voicemail tab. I'm on Facebook, Captain Jeff, or actually Airline Pilot Guy is the best place to go on Facebook. On Twitter, I'm at Airline Pilot Guy. And Stitcher Radio. I mean, a lot of people are listening to my show on Stitcher Radio. It's they call it smart radio. You can download an app for your mobile phone, your tablet device. You can get it in your car, fancy car system, audio system. It's all over the place. Stitcher is becoming more and more prevalent in the new media world, and if you want to get an app for your device, head over to stitcher.com/airlinepilot. Not Airline Pilot Guy, just Airline Pilot, and you can download it there. And remember that Stitcher Smart Radio is the smarter way to listen to radio. And until next time, wishing you clear skies, unlimited visibility, and tailwinds. Take care, and God bless. All right, recorder's off. I'm almost an hour late meeting my co-pilot downstairs for dinner. I hope he's not mad at me. I'm going to go here and turn the video off. All right. Thank you, everybody in video land, YouTube land, for watching the video. And until next time, have a great week and take care.
Good day.